Okay, so today we are going to talk about the topic of pediatric vocal pedagogy. It's been a t Tell you, before the pandemic, I did my first group class with younger singers. Until that point, the youngest age student I had taught was a sixth grader, but primarily I was focusing on high school age and students who were in choir and wanted to compete in the Allstate process and do solo and ensemble and things like that. The benefit I found from having a voice class of younger students from a practical standpoint was it was more affordable for parents to get their children started in vocal study by doing the group class. And that then led to students wanting to continue with the class for a while. But then I have students currently that stuck through the pandemic madness and are still voice students now and are doing absolutely beautiful work. So I was able to teach them some things and adjust their mindset and the way that they perceive their own voices and what is a good sound through the voice class experience. That's my personal experience on it. But the pandemic came, and really, I only had 1 year. That was the summer before. So I only had 1 year where it was like we were all together. Then we tried some online classes. Then we came back together sort of after about a year or so. And I didn't have the opportunity to continue the flow the way I wanted to. So this time I'm going to do it again. We're going to see what happens. But that's neither here nor there. So, teaching voice lessons to young students has been a controversial topic forever. Still is. People today still. I was confronted at a Allstate level competition where I was judging high schoolers at a very high level, and a 20-something year old master's student about to start his career. Was talking about how, you shouldn't teach young singers and how he never would and he can't believe all the things that you hear people say. And I challenged him on it and I, expressed like, parents are gonna put their kids in music lessons. Parents invest in their children. If their child says they want to take lessons, parents are going to get them lessons if they can make it happen. And unfortunately, at least in my area, and I'm pretty sure it's the same in all areas. There are a lot of people unqualified to do this job. They think just because they like to sing and they have some experience doing so that they can just then suddenly know how to teach children healthy singing techniques. I doubt they even care about healthy singing techniques. That's just me being a little bit biased. So the kids will be turned away from teachers with a solid background in acoustic singing, and then go to studios where the teachers are 20 years old at the junior college, and they may or may not be qualified, have any experience to do the job. That's an actual example of something happening in this area. Not only that, the kids are being paid like $8 an hour, but the studio is charging $75 an hour for these kids to teach these young voices. So the parents are paying a ridiculous amount of money for questionable value, potentially harmful. So that's a 4-minute rant I just went on. Let's get to the story. Pediatric vocal pedagogy is controversial. In the past, students who wanted to study voice were encouraged to take piano lessons or violin, Suzuki method, anything but sing until they got through puberty and or were around the age of 14, 16. because they wanted to encourage music literacy and the reading of music and strengthening of the ear, and all of those are great, but we can do that in voice lessons with young kids. There's no reason why we shouldn't be able to. And thankfully, the American Academy of Teachers of Singing finally endorsed the teaching of young children in the early 2000s. However, as I told you, even today, 20 years later, there are still people being educated that you don't teach young children to sing. And then as a result, they're not being taught how to teach young children to sing. And as a result, there's no opportunity for the youngsters to have quality education. So the idea that, you know, children are just going to sit around quietly waiting for their larynx to grow before they can start singing is a little bit silly. You're going to hear children singing loudly as soon as they're able to do so. And today, whereas in the past, children's singing activities were all focused on loft singing, you know, church singing, singing folk songs, you know, just light, fun singing. Today, children are singing Beyonce and other such types of big, loud, belty singing. They're trying to sound like adults when they're only 8, 9, 10 years old. Well, this is entirely inappropriate because they're not that age. Their voices are not even fully developed. The structures aren't even the same in all the layer developments. But also, these children are modeling voices after adults, but these adults are recordings, and these recordings are not even authentic representations of the student's sounds. They are auto-tuned and modified in a myriad of ways to basically be robotic approximations of the human singing voice. Even the artists themselves often do not sound like their recorded versions. So these children get these low self-image, this like, I can never be, I cannot do, or they can try to and end up straining and creating a lot of habits and just sticky situations that are going to be challenging to take care of and rectify when they are finally at the right age to be learning how to sing. So that's a reason to go ahead and start teaching them now. I love this example of vocal athletes and this corollary of singers to athletes. And especially when you think about it at the young age, we have ballerinas, you know, there's the little league softball, football, just gymnastics. Oh my God. All these activities that are muscular strengthening activities, coordination strengthening activities. We don't prevent children from doing them when their bodies are growing. In fact, they're often encouraged to participate, to get better balance, to get more coordinated within their bodies. And in the case of ballet, it's seen as necessary to start children at a very young age so they can learn the vocabulary of ballet. They can learn the fundamental skills, musicality skills, of rhythm and dancing at legato and staccato and different feelings like that. It's all just like voice. But somehow we say, oh, well, it's okay that we start training newly trained toddlers, but we can't train an 8-year-old. It doesn't make sense. What's important is that we teach them to sing in loft. We teach them musicality, we teach them sight reading, and we have fun. We teach them that singing is fun, right? So that's one of the most important things. So like on the topic of fun, I have a couple of resources here. One comes from the Full Voice curriculum. Let's see if I have a little book I can show you. Eek. So it's the Full Voice. And it's a program for music reading, but it's targeted to singers, so it's really great. I recommend checking them out. But I love this game right here. You get these little cards. And let's say we have worked on just these few things here, okay? So we put the cards out and we ask the kids, we have them sing do, re, mi, re, do, right? But then ask them, we'll rearrange them. We'll say, okay, can you sing do, mi, re, right? And you ask them to sing that. And then they do. And then you say, okay, can you put them in a different order? Okay, what about mi, do, re? And then you ask, you say, and then I'll sing the one that you wrote. So we're teaching the music writing, but we're also practicing sight reading and ear training and all that stuff. So having fun with this. This kids love this game. High schoolers love this game. I did this with high schoolers all the time. Their favorite thing was to try and trip me up. Of course, we're using the accidentals in high school, the fee and the raw, Ray Rado. We're using all of those as well. But you just sort of build up as you start to expand a student's reading and what they're exposed to in the scale. You just keep adding on these things and it gets more and more fun and ridiculous. And they love it when they can trip the teacher up. So it's fun to have fun with the kids in that way. I love these little cards. Let's see. There's this little book that I've scanned into my computer. So I can't find the original book anymore. But so I just printed out what I have. But it's vocalized and it's got really fun things that you can do with little kids. I like this one, feet are firmly planted. Feet are firmly planted on the ground. Anyway, the warm-up works through getting their voice moving, but it's also getting techniques in their head, important things. We keep our feet still when we're performing. They have another one here about release, relax, avoid any strain, free from all tension, tightness, and pain. And you're singing, so, do, do, ti, ti, la, so, fa, so. So it's just, you know, head down work, but using words to remind the students of important techniques about singing. We have some about relaxing the shoulders, that though the notes may rise, our chin stays level. So important, especially for the boys who think they have to sing with their chins. Dropping your jaw, taking time to breathe instead of gasping for breath. I like this one. And like everybody says, the tip of the tongue, the lips, the teeth, you know, another version of that is in here. I like the sing legato, sing staccato for style. And this is cute. I would do this earlier. Do, do is like a rock. Re is like a ramp, mi is like a table, fa's thumbs down, so is like a wall, la is like a hook, ti is like ti, one finger, do is like a rock. It's just cute. It's just fun. And you see these little ones starting to do this and they love it. They love to learn, and exposing them to these things seems intimidating at first, or at least it did to me. But my experience was that the kids were game for anything I was excited about. I'm not going to go through these, but this is a cute book of tongue twisters, and it has an accompaniment track, but I rarely use it. We'll just sing them a cappella and work on wherever the kids' voices range are. This was the statement from the Academy about, yay, teach kids to sing because it's appropriate. There's no reason not to. Okay, so here, this book right here is absolutely fantastic. 100% recommend it. Full of great information and ideas, but specifically. So we go through here, it's like, great, 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 great information. At the back, they have, you know, the list of fun supplies you might want to include in your voice studio for kids, as well as different warm-ups and tongue twisters at the back in the appendix. But starting at section three, it breaks down what a voice lesson would look like by age group. And so right here is age 5 to 7. And every single level has the 5 important things. We have the mind-body warm-ups. The mind-body warm-ups, breathing, posture, musicianship, vocalizing, and repertoire. So all levels have that, but then she gives you ideas and ways to do this age appropriately in the brackets. In this section, I've marked a couple of things that I thought were great, like ways to teach how to stand. She says, put your feet together. Now zipper them apart so you're like in a V, and then push your heels out. And then that's getting your feet settled underneath you just right. And that's a cute little girl right there. Love it. I love this too. Look, practicing breathing using a pinwheel, which I thought was brilliant. The pitch motion. I enjoy this idea here where you put a piece of string on the floor and you have the student make it do different wiggly lines. Then they run their finger along the line they made and sing going up and down. It's fun. A little activity. You can keep the kids doing things, not just standing there doing vocal work, studying, but you can make it more active. They're going to have more fun. Recommends echo songs, and I echo that sentiment. Rhythm games. I like this one on page 29. It's like keeping a steady beat, and you play this game. Chop, chop, chippity chop. What do we want to make? And then the kids tell you what they want to make, and we try to keep a beat. Today we make spaghetti. What goes in spaghetti? And then we just go through the whole thing, and they tell me, and then we add in the rhythms, and you try to keep a steady beat while you say the words. Improvisation, keeping a beat, and silly and fun. And when you mess up, laugh, because people who are laughing learn way better than people who are stressed out and freaked out. So making it fun, keeping them happy. Anyway, it keeps going on, and the idea is to have it be game and play based while teaching fundamental skills, keeping them in loft register, and teaching musicality, using props as necessary and appropriate. Oh my gosh, I love this one. This is expression exercises, singing with emotion. And this one is, do mi so, mi so, so mi so mi do. I'm really happy. Have them sing with a happy face. I'm really happy. And change the words. I'm really angry. And like, how else could they express that? Not just with their face, but with the word. What kind of musicality, like accents? I'm really sleepy. And let them have fun with different emotions and feelings and changing it up in there. So cute. Love it very much. Anyway, this is a great book if you want to consider teaching youngsters. I think this is a really good resource. Okay. And the next thing is talking about musicality and sight reading. This is also the full voice. They have these sample pages you can just print out. And you can use them in your lessons right now, but they give you an idea of what's in the what materials are available. So sight reading. Do re do re mi fa. Do re mi fa. Do re mi fa. Right, so you follow along and the kids can do that. They have the hand signs they're working on available to them. And there's a rhythm page, but it's included with solfege syllables. You could break this up and do it just tas and tees. And then you could have them sing the solfege on the rhythms they just worked on. So I think that's an advantage of the full voice. These are cards. This is just more of the same, but these are like sturdier and you can use them in your lessons. Another great resource is the Royal Academy Music Theory, but I think especially for young beginning students, who are singers and not pianists, this is not the best choice. The material is basically the same, right? We're learning about musicality markings. We're learning note values, lines, but they also include a lot of keyboard work, a lot of keyboard work, right? I mean, some is appropriate and necessary. Good stuff here. But with the full voice, and this is the same level, the primary stuff starts with our solfege-based system, right? So we're learning that from the very beginning. And then we start applying that to the concepts, right? So you're learning all the same things, but it's from a vocalist point of view. And I think it's more user-friendly. I think that the kids will have more fun with this book, especially at the very young level. Later, moving them on into, once you've worked through all the full voice stuff, into some of this is a really good idea. And they have tests and things where you can get certifications, awards and stuff. I think awards, by the way, are controversial, I know, but I do think they motivate children to keep working. And on that note, we'll talk about, move on to songs. Because the next important thing, you know, we're teaching them how to sing with loft register. We're teaching them about musicality and how to read music and being literate, not learning by rote, but learning music, and explain to them why that's important. The people who did, who performed the, let's say, Hamilton for the first time, or who did The Greatest Showman, or any other show that they think is great and they love, talk about the first people to ever see that music. Like, there was no model available for them. They had to look at it and just sing it and create the character and create, like, what we understand now began with someone who has never heard it, looked at the music, and sang it. And that it's a really cool thing that if they learn this skill, they could have opportunities to do similar activities where they're able to create something from their minds the way they want it to be, instead of just being copying cats of others. It's a complicated concept. Definitely not immediate gratification, but I think kids, they respond to that kind of thing. All right, so song selection. So in our curriculum, we have this awesome book, and it gives us the opportunity. My daughter's trying to sneak by. So we can create our own rubrics, right? And it's really, really good that we have that opportunity, and we can create that. This book here is another resource. It's very similar, and I'm going to show you the last page, which I think is the most user-friendly. So this is listed by anthology. So you'll see all the songs are listed, and then over here is their rubric for how they classified songs. Individual things, their total score, and then the rank. Ranks are 1 through 3. So 3, I mean, that's high school. I mean, and for some high schoolers though were going to sing at level 1, and that's okay. You're trying to pick songs that are meeting your students' needs, period. Right? So if you've got a kid that has the perfect ear and understands musicality and all these things, but they can't breathe, you look at this rubric and you look for breath and you look for places where phrasing, you look for ones. Like, let's find something where this kid can breathe, but then find something that challenges their ear. So look for a 3 on melody and the harmony. So I really, really like it a lot. When looking for young children, I'm looking for like a 7, 8 in this book right here, and the total rank. And then I look to find the song. The other thing is good, you can see the total rank, the total score and the ranks of all the songs in the collection. And it can help you decide which collections to buy. If you're like me and you've got a limited budget, you can be more strategic about your song choice. Second resource is, I'm in this organization called the National Federation of Music Clubs, and we have this event called Gold Cup that my kids participate in. It's a good event. You get, it's like solo and ensemble, you get comments from a judge. The judge gives you a score. 5 points is what you're trying to get, so that's like superior. And after you've accumulated 15 points in your category, you earn a little trophy. And then you earn a bigger trophy and bigger. It's motivating to the kids. Also, it's long-term planning and like working towards a long-term goal, which I think is just really important for kids to have that opportunity to do things like that. But the point is, they have, the event requires them to sing 2 songs, and they have specific songs listed for each level. And they're all English, and they're all American, which is very unique. Anyway, I like this right here. I don't always like every song in every category, and that's okay. I don't have to. But you'll put your kids in the category where they belong developmentally, and I usually put them a little bit lower than where I think they belong. And then you pick a song, and it's got the collection listed, song titles. I think this is a really great, like, this is actually how I began learning beginner music. Because, you know, what they say about voice teachers are usually have degrees in vocal performance, usually. And they were usually in voice lessons in high school. And they typically only sang advanced music from the time they started lessons. And that is the case for me. I mean, my first solo was Danza Danza, and I was a 6th grader. What? That doesn't even make sense. So, you know, clearly my voice teacher and my choir teacher had the same problem I did, which was they were not exposed to the wonderful collection of music that is more age appropriate for children. So I'm singing La Danza. Then I sang, I think, Per la Gloria. And I can't remember. So that was the 7th and 8th grade. So La Danza Danza, Per la Gloria. Man, I went through all of them. Il mio bel fuoco. I sang basically only Italian songs all the way through. I loved it. But I dare say I probably would have loved these other songs too had I been given an opportunity. And I only learned 1 song because it was so challenging that it took a whole semester of intense focus on 1 song to get it to an appropriate level versus being able to learn multiple songs and thereby learning multiple skills and developing myself into a more well-rounded musician. I could go on a soapbox. I think I've already gone on a soapbox, whatever. Okay, so songbook collection. So the RCM books, whereas I don't like their theory, their songbooks are awesome. So this songbook right here, so at the beginning, I mean, you can start introducing children to IPA right at the beginning. And I have started doing that with my high schoolers. I don't teach them their words by rote anymore. I give them an IPA transcription, and then we work through it, and I make them read the IPA. And they hate it until they love it, right? But they hate it. I'm not going to lie. They are like, they hate it so much. But then the next year when we're doing Allstate, and I say, that needs to be a schwa, or that needs to be an open E, or that needs to be whatever. Close that O, make it a closed O. They know what I mean, and they catch on faster. So then they see, oh, now I know why we're doing this. I still hate it, but I'm gonna do it anyway. So, but if we, you know, we can start with our littles, teaching them this language, this skill, this tool to help them be better singers. and more independent singers. Next, we have the songs, and they're listed by, you know, time period, basically, and genre. And you'll see, I did. So I used the little book I showed you, Songs for Young Singers, and I notated a couple of songs, like what their level was, what their points were. And then over here, I put in why. So for the Skyboat song, the reason it got an 8 instead of a 7 is because it's got more challenging rhythms. Great, we can do that. And then the Viva, the French Canadian folk songs, has challenging text, because I'm not even gonna try and say that French right now without thinking about it, rhythm and dynamics. So for me, even though that's a level grade 1, it's 10 points, I'm not giving that to young kids. I might even give that to a high schooler as their first French song. But all the other elements are really easy, so they can focus on language, right? So let's look at those two songs. We have on page 8, Skyboat song. And the range of the song is listed at the very beginning. They have D to D. It's a little high for some, but it might be just right for others, right? You'll see that it's strophic. It's got the two verses, but the repeated chorus. It's 2 pages long. I think it's a really great choice for a young singer, provided the range is appropriate. Every song in here is formatted the same way. They're almost all in the same range, D to D or C to D, just generally about there. So they're in an appropriate tessitura for a young singer. So the I know that this topic goes on forever. We can also talk about the changing voice through puberty. We all know boys go through a voice change. Girls do too. And it's not to where we're changing octaves, but it's still issues affected with the vocal folds growing. And I don't have time to go into that completely, but I wanted to show you these two choices for songs for the cambiata. Little male changing voice. I've got one right now. He's so cute. I could just eat him up. I love him. But he's in stage 1, and oh my God, his range is different every week. You have to be ready to change keys on the spot. So, I mean, although a grand piano is awesome, I prefer a electric piano that gives me the transposition option. So when my little boy comes in and his G to A range, C on a really good day, right? But G to A, shifts up or down or whatever. Like this is him. We're all over the place. I can just use my transposition key and still play in the same key we've been working in. On that note, also the Accompanist app is fantastic. It's Accompanist. I love it. It's right there. It has a black box with an A in it. Because we're working on a song. I'll just pick 42nd Street because it's the first one listed. It's got the accompaniments here, right? But I can change the key for my little guy. I can change the key up, right? So that's helpful because I'm not exactly the world's best piano player. I can do some chords and play scales and play their music notes, but I am not gonna accompany them in any way, shape, or form. And that helps me keep with his voice change. But what I like about this particular collection is that it's easier to use because all the ranges are just listed right there. What I don't like is, I don't know, sometimes I feel like the ranges, it doesn't hit the exact right spot. It's a little too much at times for his stage 1. Maybe, stage 2 better. But I like this one much better. So the boy's changing voice. The ranges on this one are a lot better. All Through the Night, Orly, Barbara Allen, all the songs you expect. When you look at the ranges of them, you know, it sits within a less than one octave range for the most part, and they're not putting the low note at F almost ever. It's G, and we're not pushing it above A too much either. So sometimes, I mean, slightly stretched more because this song will work for multiple stages of his development, but it's really great for me starting in this level one. I am sorry for this 35-minute video of me rambling about the importance of teaching young singers. I want to recap what my point was, which is in the past and still currently is being taught that you shouldn't teach young children to sing because it is dangerous to their vocal development. However, the American Academy of Teachers of Singing disagrees and has made a statement in support of this field. The most important thing is to have it be fun, to stay in loft register, teach musicianship skills that they would be learning in piano class, language like they would be learning in ballet, and choose song selections. Make sure the song selections are developmentally appropriate and meeting the needs of your specific children. So I hope you found this helpful, with some information that you can use. So anyway, bye.